Sarrabalho bem dançado, sarrabalho bem dançado, faz chorar, faz padecer. Também faz os seus amantes, também faz os seus amantes, seus amores esquecer.
Welcome to Livramento, one of the most unique cities anywhere in the world. A city with breathtaking sights and views, a rich culture of tradition and community, and one truly amazing feature. A border between Brazil and Uruguay running straight through the middle. One side Livramento and Brazil, the other Rivera and Uruguay. Two very different cities with their own identities, currency and language, but to the residents, one giant community. Meet Flavia Davila, a native of Livramento who has spent the last 6 years living, studying and working in Edinburgh, Scotland. Flavia, in joint with Creative Scotland, has organised a project in which six young creatives from Scotland have flown all the way to her city to bring a fresh way of thinking to the residents and to hopefully change their views on theatre in general. Flavia's main focal point? The border itself, and how we can use theatre to break down our own barriers and borders. Over the next 3 weeks, Flavia and her team will be working with each other and local creatives in a mixture of classes and workshops, ranging from traditional Brazilian dance to vocal and physical theatre. They hope to create a final ephemeral performance for the residents of the city to come and watch, and to open their minds to the different styles of theatre and the performing arts. To start off the project, the girls are given a tour of the city to familiarise them with the local area and to give them a flavour of the environment they are going to be working in over the next coming weeks. The tour highlights the main differences between Livramento and Rivera by showing the stark contrasts not only in the city's appearances, but the attitudes of its residents and governments, Livramento being much more of a traditional and relaxed nature, while Rivera is the more modernised counterpart. Flavia sets the task of exploration to the group and asks them to investigate the local market, which sits on the border, to get first-hand experience of the differences between the two cities and then to report back on their findings.
I don't know, it's really strange because on your left you've got all, you know, these quite sort of ramshackle, homemade looking market stalls, tarpaulins over the top, things spilling out into the street, and then over on the Uruguayan side you've got what look like bus shelters, really. I mean, whereas, you know, on this side, I mean, anyone literally looks like they can just turn up and start selling.
It's the Brazil side, which is obviously kind of much more messy, disorganised, but more interesting perhaps. It's more enticing for you to go in and have a look at all these different things, even though they're probably selling the exact same items on each side.
It's just quite something seeing the two things like so close together and knowing that you're obviously standing on the border of two different countries that work quite differently.
After the task is completed, the girls return to a local park to discuss their findings and what the contrast between the cities means to them and how they can incorporate them into a performance piece, which is to be developed over the coming weeks. When back in the multicultural centre, Flavia asks the group to report back on what they have discovered.
We talked about kind of some of the images that had stuck with us and struck us kind of in the strongest way, and started talking about the market and how that had been just a really like clear image of the difference, right, in one view. Yeah,
because we said frontiers are something that connects, and so it really, was really clear when the strongest image we had.
You mean the street vendors up there?
No, first, not, I mean the strongest image of when frontiers are something that connects is the frontier where the obelisk is, the fountain, this is like something, just connection, dialogue and everything. And then instead, what was we thought, what was the strongest image about what, like when a frontier border is something that separates, there's a gap, and there was the market that we all agree was the strongest one we had.
And just purely because that is such an obvious difference, like, I know we were saying, obviously the shops are different and view that, but that, right, because they were right beside each other, you can see it right there. We tried to go back and take some kind of pictures to capture that, because obviously on one side you've got these new kind of fancy hut stalls and they look all shiny, and then on the other side obviously you've got that big space as well where obviously they used to be, so that's a physical gap there. You can really, really see that between the two.
And we went there and said, oh, why we don't experience with all of our senses
what someone's talking about,
go through the with the sound and the smell and
the space you had as well,
the space. On the Brazilian side, you've got people that have just set up, they don't even have one of them, the what are they called, bankers?
There's
some people just have like some a table that, well, you know, that they put up on the street and following your line of vision up, so you have the, you know, the tarpaulin little ones on the Brazilian side, and then you've got this like weird like bus shelter style on the left. Then you look up and you see the casino, glass and concrete, and then on the right side you've got the kind of crumbling old colonial buildings, all the power lines are clear, and like available, you know, nothing's hidden, right? You can see everything and all that's kind
of exposed.
Ramshackle glory, I suppose.
So I was saying to Bia, those ones on the Brazilian side, the people living in those, she was saying, I was saying, that's a thing for them. They're actually looking down and seeing that right there, the casino's right across, which is obviously so shiny and brand new, and then the place that they are kind of looking down on is such a, you know, a juxtaposition between the two, total opposite kind of thing. So we went back and walked around both of those with the senses thing instead of walking around.
Did you buy anything in the market?
No,
we were looking though to see if we sold the same thing. That's what we're asking. Sell the same things at the same prices, and I thought they seem to be pretty much the same.
Yeah.
And the approach of people was really
different. They weren't really the same. I didn't think.
The items
when we started looking at what was for sale on one side and it wasn't just how it was presented. Do you know what I mean? It wasn't like there was that one stall that had all of the like CDs and DVDs all just like filed in together in this big table. But on the other side, it just felt like more of the items were, I mean, maybe they're all from, you know, made in China, made in processed in whatever plant in whatever part of the world, but it felt like things, maybe just the way that they were displayed and they had more space, but it also felt like they were more like branded goods and like more, I mean,
there weren't any clock stand and they all looked really plastic and made, and there's no stuff right at the very end.
Yeah.
But just because of the way those doors opened, automatically cause a divide between whoever's selling in this stall and whoever's selling the one next door. So they are making a kind of gap between each of those, whereas the other ones, because their goods are sprawled right out, they're standing on the front, which means they're actually quite beside each other, they can communicate much easier, whereas those are literally behind this kind of little screen, like a blind date or something.
The group then go on to share further observations through photographs and sketches they made during their time investigating the market, and sharing their thoughts on how to portray these differences through performance with Flavia. They end the day on a high note, and an early night is now in order, as tomorrow the group has an interview with a local radio station to raise awareness of the project, and then the real work begins with their first workshop. It's an early start to the day, with a guest spot on local radio RCCFM to raise the awareness of the project amongst the locals and to let them know what to expect over the next 3 weeks in their city centre. With Flavia translating for the audience at home, we all answer questions on what we think of the city so far in our stay.
I think all of us have to kind of admit that it's very inspiring, especially the international park yesterday when we kind of found out about the different stages and what each thing symbolises. I think those are really strong themes that can really, really influence whatever we come up with. So I think the roots of our work that we're going to eventually devise and establish is going to have really strong roots of that, and I just hope that our end result really speaks to people from both sides and they can really see that we've tried to understand this situation as well as we can and put that out there. So I'm hoping
the interview is a success, and now the real work begins.
This is our first workshop today, the first practical workshop. We are starting to work with creation and composition. Now what they're doing is they are working with the body expression of images that they saw yesterday and on the first day. So we've been walking around town, we've been told the history of the place. These guys went and did a little project yesterday. They chose one place and that represented the border to them. That was the most representative of the border so far. So they're now working with composing images based on what they saw yesterday. And today is going to be mostly about that, about transposing one image to another, transposing something that you saw outside, incorporating that and expressing that yourself. And in the afternoon, we're going to be working a bit with spoken words. We're going to be doing a bit of storytelling, and we're going to work with song as well and try to get a group song going, and that'll be interesting.
After splitting the group into pairs, it is now up to each person's partner to decide how to model their expressions of what stood out most from the border and to aid in the transition between each expression. By focusing on the transposing of real-world images into a performance, the group will have a better way of acting out what they have come up with at the end of the project. Once everyone's shown their pieces to the group, Flavia asks local acting student Bia Dutra to become a model for everyone to work with. Just as they have done in pairs, now the group must work together to produce something for an audience to watch.
There's a folkloric character. There's a character in the Brazilian folklore that hops in one leg and he's like a protector of the forests.
So she's
Yeah.
Sassy.
So what they're doing now, I was supposed to speak now. Yeah, okay. What they are doing just now is they are creating a world map in front of us here. So they're reading the hall, looking at the hall like this, as if it's a map of the world, like the ones we have in school. So we're going obviously with the Eurocentric view because that's what we're used to. So Americas are over here, that's Europe, and then you get Africa and Asia over there. What these guys are going to do to start with, they're getting a chair and placing it at what would be their birthplace. And then we're going to start working from there. They're negotiating just now.
The girls begin by tying their wool to their countries of birth, and then begin to travel the map to all the countries they have visited in their lifetimes. When they cross strings with another member of the group, they are to share a story or a memory from the location with their partner. This is mostly to allow the group to bond over personal experiences in different locations around the world, but also to show that storytelling can be one of the most effective ways of breaking down barriers and borders. The world has been mapped and crossed many times, and the girls have shared their stories and discovered new tales and adventures. Now everyone must choose a story they liked and come up with a short performance piece inspired by it, then perform it for the rest of the group.
So it was really fun to kind of exchange the stories, and then it was really good to see everyone sharing, to see how people work on things and what they kind of come up with on their own. So that was good to kind of see where where people came from. We had loads of different things. We had some, you know, a monologue, we had some music, so it was nice to see everyone's skills kind of coming into practice, and that's the first chance we've had to do that today, so it was really, really good. Is that cool?
Okay, so here we are at our fourth day of the project, second day of practical workshops. Today we've got Tanisi Kahali, that's the girl in pink there, and she is a local actress, director, clown, bit of everything. I've known her for about 19 years. We grew up doing drama together at school, and she was just telling us all her story. She went to study acting in Brazil. She's got a lot of experience in different types of acting and education, and she's here today to work with the group, do a bit of street performance, which is slightly different in Brazil than it is in the UK. And you see how that works in a minute.
Tanisi starts the workshop by setting the girls some physical challenges to get them used to working with their entire bodies and to make them more aware of the spaces around them. By doing this, they are better prepared for their performances on the streets of the city. As Brazilian street performing mostly consists of physical theatrics, Tanisi is showing the group that the best way to maintain an audience in her city is to stand out, be that through large physical gestures, or even loud vocal elements. In the rest of the world, street performers are often welcomed in public spaces, providing entertainment for all ages by showing off their wide variety of skills and humour. However, Livramento takes a different stance to its street theatre. Tanisi warns that in the past, during her performance, she has been subject to both physical and verbal abuse by passers-by and local businesses, with one encounter even leaving her soaked after a bucket of water was thrown at her. After a morning of intense physical theatre, the group head home for a quick lunch before returning for an afternoon of dancing in the streets. But then, disaster strikes.
We're stranded in the house. We can't go out back to the rehearsal venue because the street is flooded.
The rain has finally passed, and the group are eager to get started in the afternoon's dancing class. So eager, in fact, they seem to have started early.
We are meant to continue our work on the street, but it's pissing down with rain, so we're going to work in here. What she wants to do is she wants to work a little bit with Brazilian traditional songs and rhymes. So we're going to do a bit of that in a minute, just to get the playfulness going.
Before the dancing and singing begin, the group begin to discuss ideas they were working on over lunch with Tanisi and Flavia regarding how to put together a public performance and the different ways to grab the audience's eye. With ideas ranging from a group song to procession, Alice comes up with a very interesting idea.
So for mine, each person would be linked by having a balloon. And it would be like, so somewhere that's already busy, so like somewhere that people are already sitting in, and just to get like a sense of like something's about to happen. We would do an overture using a balloon as our instrument. So you'd have like the squeaker section, and then you'd have the drummer section, and then maybe like the plucking section.
A pessoa informar tipo de uma orquestra só com balões.
Yeah, so seriam
já sentados, mas cada um com seu balão, e daí teria, né, a sessão da percussão, a sessão do...
And maybe you'd have a conductor as well, like
Daí botar um maestro para chamar todo mundo.
You know how the orchestra opens like the
como a abertura de concerto numa orquestra,
né? But it would be something eye-catching as well, and then like could end in like in a pose, and like
bang, 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 bang,
and then it could begin.
Once everyone has put forward their ideas, Tanisi gets the group up on their feet and begins to teach them some traditional folk songs and dances to give them a starting point for their public performances. First, Tanisi teaches the group Cirandero, often referred to as the circle dance, as it is a folk song about the sieving of flour, which is usually performed in a circle.
O cirandeiro, cirandeiro, oh, a pedra do teu anel brilha mais do que o sol. O cirandeiro, cirandeiro, oh, a pedra do teu anel brilha mais do que o sol. O cirandeiro, cirandeiro, oh, a pedra do teu anel.
Yeah, well today was really interesting because this morning we were talking about all the things that you could face by doing street performance and the different types of street performance, like the different formations of it. You could have a line or a semicircle or a full circle, and it was really interesting, and I think we were all like a little bit surprised by the fact that they've all experienced kind of, well, just like physical violence in the street. You know, just the first person in the line has been met with aggression or smacked or something like that, because people
hit with umbrellas
aren't really keen on street theater, or they're not really used to it, so even if everyone is in costume they don't necessarily react well. And that's not to say that everyone is that way, but they said, you know, you need to be really prepared and quite tough to do it.
What I did expect is that we would have a street to perform on, that we would like do a bit of street performance, but actually the street disappeared in the rain and now it's just a river, and so we decided not to do river performance.
Yes, because no one would be watching us, they'd be floating down the street.
Well, hello. We are on the third workshop day and we've got Ellie. Hi, today we're doing our third practical workshop. It's not gonna happen. Today's our third workshop, and Ellie arrived last night from Spain. So she is going to take the group today and do a bit of physical and vocal preparation. So she works a lot with actor dramaturgy, and she's an educator and actress in Europe, and she will be working with them just now on that dramaturgy of the actor.
Ellie Sogorb joins the group today, not only as a new teacher in vocal and physical theatre, but as a fully fledged member of the group. Her main job is to open up everyone's lungs to get them working on how to control and carry their voices for their upcoming outdoor performances. A word of warning, it is about to get a little loud in here. Ellie splits everyone into pairs as puppets and their masters, with the masters controlling both the puppets' direction of movement and which part of the body is to lead them as they walk, all the while maintaining a strong, clear vocal note. In doing this, the group are being trained to balance their focus on both aspects of their performance for the final piece at the end of the project. Finally, Ellie gathers the group into a circle to create a vocal melting pot for everyone to throw their voices into and to see what sort of things they can come up with. This not only gets the vocal cords working overtime, but shows that when everyone is contributing, even in their own small way, something big and beautiful can be created.
This is Ellie. She ran our morning session today. She's our physical and vocal prep person. And we're just going to ask her a couple of questions here. She's going to reply in Spanish, because she's beautiful that way. Bueno, ¿qué te pareció el grupo esta mañana?
Muy buen trabajo. La verdad es que muy interesante porque han entendido muy bien el lenguaje en el que les estaba hablando y lo han cogido enseguida, que es lo interesante.
She thought that the work was very good, it went really well, the group understood the exercises, they understood the language that she wanted to work with, the corporal and vocal language, really quickly, and they came up with really interesting stuff. Y bueno, ¿qué te parece para dónde van desde aquí? ¿Qué te parece el potencial del grupo?
Pues me parece estupendo porque sobre todo esa confianza que han mostrado sin saber ni mi línea de trabajo ni nada, pero que han mostrado una confianza plena de tú mandas, hacemos. Eso es, a mí dice mucho para mí de un profesional, ¿no?
She felt a lot of confidence in the group. She felt that she can, there's a lot of trust, mutual trust in the group. They have this feeling of, yeah, you say it, we'll do it, and that's one of the things that she likes the most in a professional, so she thinks the group can achieve great stuff, great things from now on.
The afternoon session consists of local theatre director and actor Michel Cross dropping by to lend his expertise in local theatre and textual work. Before the group arrive, Michel asks that each of them bring an object that meant something personal to them. Frivolous or sentimental, as long as they could talk to the rest of the group about their feelings and memories surrounding the item. The workshop is finished early, and the group call it a day. And so ends the first week of workshops. It's the weekend, a time for relaxing and reflecting on the week just gone. But not for this group. No, Flavia has arranged for a barter session between the group and the locals of Livramento, in which everybody who attends must perform in one way or another for everybody else. Our group have prepared a small performance based on what they've been working on in their first week, and this seems the perfect way to judge an audience's reaction before unleashing it on the masses of the city. It's also a great way to swap and share songs and dances from both nations.
La salsa no tiene frontera, la música no tiene barrera.
Oh, leave them alone. It's Sunday. Let them sleep.
Okay, week two. Hey, get excited. Woo! Get excited for the camera. Woo! All right, we are going to do a bit of field activities. We're going to start with some individual work. So it's very simple. What I want you to do is, in your own time, just now, as soon as I finish explaining this, you are going to go either into Rivera or into Livramento and wander for half an hour, making eye contact with as many people as possible. Just that. And then once you've done your half an hour in your respective city, cross over and do the same again for another half an hour. And then come back here and free write for half an hour your experiences. Okay?
Right.
So off they go to mix with the locals. The aim of the exercise is to learn about the interactions with the people of both cities and whether there are any differences in their responsiveness at all. We follow Jesse around Rivera for a while. Time to swap, and now we're off with Ellie, who seems to take an exercise on eye contact to a whole new level. After their adventures in both cities, the group comes together in the International Park again to sit and write about their experiences. But let's hear from Jessie and what she went through on her travels.
I noticed there was a big difference when you were walking with me, I think because I was accompanied by a man, and even at a bit of a distance, and because you have a nice camera that people were looking at and more interested in. I found a big difference between Rivera and Livramento. I tried like various factors. I tried, you know, walking on the sunny side of the street, the shady side of the street. I took off my sunglasses. I found people much more likely in Livramento to make eye contact. It was a really, really interesting exercise. A lot more people in Uruguay, especially people selling things in the markets and the shops, would just be sitting reading something and not even look up. Didn't really seem very interested at all. And especially, it just felt like in Rivera, people were just looking away immediately. If they made eye contact with you, they'd just avoid it. A lot of them, and on both sides, a lot of people just looking at my shoes, at my sandals, because they're really like multicolored, and I probably stand out like a sore thumb here, because I'm so white.
You're all back. Well done. You all survived. And I will be looking forward to hearing all about it, but we're going to do the second part of the task first. So you'll have a little bit of paper. Can you just tell me if you have a number one or a number two? Can I have the number ones in Brazil and the number twos in Uruguay, please?
Part two of today's exercise is to split everyone into pairs and assign them into separate cities to explore. This time with a twist in the design. One of the pair is blindfolded, so as to experience each city with their other senses, to see if they can feel a difference in either city, as opposed to just their appearances. It's said that when the sense of sight is removed, all other senses are heightened. So let's see if each city has something to reveal that has until now remained hidden.
Permisso, paisano, que eu venho judiado.
It seems to be going rather well with the locals too.
Pra mate cevado, que eu ando na estrada com a vida encilhada tocando cavalo. Sou da fronteira, me pilcho a capricho. Outra dedelei da lida que eu sei aperto o serviço. Meio gente, meio bicho.
Well, of course, it has been scary because one, you have to trust the person you is guiding you, is leading you, and I don't know Anna, but not, it's nothing personal, but it's normal physically, and also I don't know the environment, so it's been quite shocking. Anyway, having overcame this, I actually enjoyed it. I always tried to guess where I was, and I think sometimes I did, maybe sometimes I not, because then the noises and everything was so, were so different from my memories about that where we are. And so I found Livramento soft. Like my steps, so I didn't know why, the feeling was like walking on a, it was always different, but I don't know, generally quite smooth and soft, like in a, on a cloud, I don't know why, don't ask me. So I felt kind of safe at the beginning, not because it was my condition, my body condition, but then after a little while, I felt safe, and it was great because she was speaking to people who were, I don't know, either staring at us or interested in what we were doing. And a lot of people ask her, what are you doing? What's this? And she said every time it's a theater workshop, work, you know, a research. And so curious people. Very gentle, because I think she asked everyone if I could touch that such and such, and everyone agreed. No one said, ah. So nice people. So yeah, it was great. I don't know. And it's strange to see the sun. So thank you. And I didn't know you were with us, Andy. So I didn't know I was followed, because when I opened my eyes, I found the camera. So I didn't know. I would have done more shows. But anyway, I hope. No, I really enjoyed it. I hope Anna did as well. Te gustado?
Following on from the previous day's exploration, the girls split into two smaller groups and are charged with the task of finding a location in either Rivera or Livramento, which could be used for a public performance. We follow Sarah, Jesse, and Alice into Livramento on their journey. The girls initially scout out previous locations they have explored before to evaluate their potential. However, Alice believes that they should be looking to new spots around the city in case they should find somewhere better.
Yeah, because maybe here is already known for us. Like, yeah.
Here we are in Livramento.
See, I think.
Walking along the borderline. Oh, look at this. Uruguay and Brazil.
Oh, so green. So Brazilian.
It's quite different from everything else.
As the girls are investigating a park, our cameraman decides to have a look around for himself to see what the area has to offer. And it's not long before he's noticed by some of the locals.
Una foto solo de mí. Dale. Yeah.
Ha ha ha!
Pretty soon, the local children begin to interact with our group and show them around their park. Alice shows them a kite which she found while exploring, but it's not long before she makes a shocking discovery. Back on the main road, Alice begins to experiment with an interactive storytelling performance in which Sarah is blindfolded and led along the border in the middle of the road. While walking along, Alice guides Sarah between the trees and bushes and tells a story which only Sarah can hear. The following day, the entire company returns to the spot with Sarah, Jesse and Alice to try out what they've come up with. With Flavia overseeing the entire operation, it seems to be going very well. After everyone has had a turn at being guided through the path and given their thoughts on how well this exercise has worked, a local of Livramento shows an interest in what the group have been up to. After a few words with Flavia, she is convinced to give it a try herself, and the results show great promise. The entire company then move on to their next location on the top of a nearby hill, which the border runs directly across. While here, they wish to witness what the other group had been working on the previous day. These giant stone markers are physical representations of where the border lies for residents to easily distinguish Brazil from Uruguay. The group has decided to use this particular marker in their performance. Thank you.
So we are here in our usual rehearsal space, CTG Frontera Aberta, and this is part of their dance group, their traditional folk dance group. They're about to show us a little bit of the Gaucho folkloric dances and traditions. So they're going to show us a dance, and then they're going to teach us how to do them. And in exchange, later on, we're going to show them some Ceilidh dancing.
Bota aqui, aí bota ali o teu pezinho bem juntinho com o meu. Aí bota aqui, aí bota ali o teu pezinho ao pé do meu. E depois não vá dizer que você já me esqueceu. E depois você já me esqueceu. Aí bota aqui, aí bota ali o teu pezinho bem juntinho.
So the group thought that after last night's Ceilidh dancing escapades, they might get an easy day to recuperate. Flavia has invited Tanisi back for the second part of her street theatre workshops, and taking what they learned from the previous week about the different ways to stand out and using some of the ideas they came up with, the group have quite a stockpile of material to work with.
Okay, we are here back with Tanisi from Compagnia per Compagnia di Teatro. Today, because the weather is actually quite nice, we are going to get to go on the street and try out some of the techniques they're practicing just now. What the group are trying to do is to get a way of calling people's attention that a street performance is about to start. So we're going to have a bit of a practice here inside the hall, and then we're going to go and try it out in the street.
Once Alice takes them through her plan, it's time for a run-through for when they head out to the International Park to perform for an audience. With Gwen on conductor duties, the routine begins to take quite a real sense of prestige. Success! A happy audience. Okay, albeit less than 10 people, but they're still happy. Let's see if attempt number 2 can do any better. Thank you. The girls then regroup with Flavia and Tanisi to discuss their thoughts on how each performance went and any particular aspects they should bring into the final piece. The general consensus being that a group performance may be the best way to initially grab the public's attention and then to break off into smaller individual performances. As a treat, local drama student Bruno Rodriguez is to teach the group a traditional street performer's song and dance routine for them to practice and learn while they're on the streets of the city. By learning a local routine, the group hopes to attract more attention from the city's residents and to show that they are keen to integrate themselves in the local culture.
A mulher do palhaço é uma beleza, cara de bunda,
princesa. O raio solta a luna, cara de palhaço no meio da rua. A mulher do palhaço é uma beleza, cara de bunda, princesa. O raio solta a luna, cara de palhaço no meio da rua. A mulher do palhaço é uma beleza, cara de bunda, princesa.
The following day marks the last of the workshops, and Ellie leads the group in a final session about body awareness and physical composition with objects. As the girls know the areas in which they will be performing their final piece, they must understand how best to use their bodies in these spaces and how to express themselves in ways language cannot. Ellie gets the group to work through a range of different exercises and styles, before finally getting them to compose short physical scenes for the others to watch.
So this is week three, and for the past 2 days the group have gone off and I've given them time to work privately on their own creative ideas. So they were working completely independently. They didn't have me or the camera following them around. So we are actually about to find out now what they've come up with, and we're going to start shaping this piece that is going to be a raw performance for our showcase, which will be the closing of the project.
After 2 days of private work, the girls are eager to get together and share their thoughts and ideas for their upcoming final piece. This being the final week of the project, all the stops are being pulled out, and as soon as everyone has had time to discuss their ideas, the group head back out to the international park to start putting them into action. First, Gwen practices her water goddess idea, whereupon Ellie and the local children she has been running private workshops with summon her from her fountain and to get her to lead the procession through the streets. The idea originated from Tanisi's workshop on street performing, using the old religions as a base for performances, in which dances were used to please ancient deities.
I'm not going to give you anything that you can actually use in this while I'm eating an ice cream, even though that's what I'm doing 90% of the time in Brazil, because I really don't want footage of me eating ice cream.
Okay. The group then head to the central altar at the head of the park to map out the dance routine they plan to perform while using the wool from their very first workshop. By using the wool to represent borders as well as the chains to hold the water goddess, the central message of borders being constrictive is made very clear for this international audience. Moving on to the next day, Flavia spends more time with the next stage of the performance upon the giant steps leading up the border towards the hill, which overlooks the entire city. Here, we'll be witnessing Sarah, Alice, Louisa and Jesse's individual pieces. But for the moment, we have more practical issues which need our attention.
This is our supposed to be our first run through in the space. We're still missing a couple of people, so we've already looked at Louisa's piece in one of the steps down there. What will happen on our performance day? We'll bring the audience from the park up here. Very interesting spots that the girls found, and it's right on the border. And we worked a bit with Louisa's step there, and now we're having a look at Alice's number, which is going to be the finale, and it's going to be up the tree. So we just had a bit of a practice to see if we could actually get her up there, and we could.
We did.
I don't know if we're going to manage to get her down before Saturday, but we'll try.
Next up, it's Jessie with her performance on her own struggles with borders and how petty rules and laws can disrupt even the most basic of plans. With Sarah aiding, we quickly flow straight into her own piece, which features an interpretation from the popular Greek myth Antigone, in which her character of a soldier is punished for breaking the laws of borders and their crossing. Back down at the International Park again, we find a similar scene to the previous day. Only this time the wool has arrived and the choreography is underway, which goes on well into the late evening. Things are certainly moving along down here. So the final day of rehearsals is upon us, and the morning is being spent on any issues the group may have faced in their performances. With Ellie doing a final run through of the dancing choreography, the pressure is really starting to kick in. After the dancing is finished, everybody heads back to base to work on any props they may require for their performance, with Ellie and Sarah stitching together sheets for Sarah's performance, and Alice finding a quiet spot to put together some homemade kites, much like the one she found in the park. Due to the nature of ephemeral art, it is the decision of Fronteiras Theatre Lab that the final performance will not be shown in this film. We do wish to share with you, however, the final dress rehearsal, and for you to witness, in part, all of the hard work the group has put into making this project come together. We thank you for your understanding.
C'è, capisce?
Uma caminhada, isso é uma festa. A gente vai fazendo festa com o público daqui até lá em cima.
Thank you.
No!
Porque sexta tudo pode acontecer. Vamos juntos dançar. Hasta que salga el sol.
¿Sabes de la mía prohibición de cruzar a frontera?
No fu justicia a promulgar el decreto. Io non credevo che i tuoi gridati ordini fossero così potenti da dare a te, che sei solo un mortale, il diritto di trasgredire le leggi non scritte, ma infallibili della natura. E non da oggi, non da ieri, ma da sempre. Tant'è che nessuno sa quando comparvero. E potevo io, per la paura di un uomo, per l'aggressività di un uomo, venire meno a tali leggi naturali? Io sono una guerriera e non ho timore di niente. Non ho paura di morire. Io sono nata mortale e molto prima del tuo decreto. Anzi, per me, che vivo da una vita in questa frontiera pacifica, i tuoi confini non hanno senso. Tu pensi che io sia loca?
Io credo che chi mi accusa di locura sia più loco di me!
And there you have it, the final run through of the performance before it's let loose upon the residents of the city in which it was created. By all accounts, a successful rehearsal, with a true feeling of accomplishment running through the group. But let's hear what they have to say about it.
Right, so that went well, actually. There are a few things that still need tweaked. The kids were a bit unsure of when to go in and out, but we'll rework that with them a little before the piece tomorrow. And now we're actually going to debrief with the whole cast to see how they felt it went.
And it was quite fun, actually. Strange for a last official rehearsal. And the energy is positive. We are kind of positive, amazingly, because yesterday, the day before, we were a bit grumpy. But it's normal, again, because we really like each other, we really love each other, but we are a bit tense.
I think today went really, really well. I was really, really happy with the way that my piece went, because I've got others in the group helping me out and doing bits, and everybody pretty much remembered what they needed to do. There are a couple of bits that I still need to choreograph and do. But it was quite exciting to do it with a little bit of a new audience, because they were reacting, and it felt like my bit went really well, even though I've still got work to do.
I don't know if it's gonna be worse tomorrow, if there won't be any audience or audience with tomatoes. I don't know.
I think the whole piece went really well. It went really smoothly. We've still got a few things to work out, a few props to get, a few kind of things to tweak. I made a wrong turn in the street, but other than that, I think it's all coming together. It's just kind of like we need one more technical rehearsal to tie everything up. So I'm quite happy and proud of us for this afternoon, and for all the kids who just jumped in and were just there doing whatever we asked. It's been really great working with them.
Anyway, I'm really glad about everything. Today I'm kind of happy, tomorrow will be a bit emotional. The day after will be dead and in risaca, cioè means a hangover. And I don't want to even think about the day in which we will leave
and neither about the flight, which I hate. Thank you.
So the project is at an end. Within 3 short weeks, these 6 young creatives from Scotland have travelled over 5,500 miles to come to Livermento to bring a fresh new way of making theatre accessible for the residents of the city, and to get them thinking about how to treat performances. They've learned a range of different skills and gained a veritable fountain of resources to use in their careers upon returning home. And hopefully, they've left more than just their mark on the locals. Flavia considers herself as both a native and a foreigner in her hometown of Livramento, and she has wanted to explore this unique perspective for a while. The encounter of her homeland with her adopted Scottish and European cultures to create a collective hybrid of performance pieces was a huge personal and professional achievement. Fronteiras Explorers was a pilot project, which made very clear that we have a wide range of possibilities yet to be investigated. Fronteiras hopes that they can move on and explore other intriguing borders around the world, and bring them their own particular style wherever they may go.
I'm